Hello, I'm Jonna Pankey. The documentary you're about to see is a labor of love and a tribute to my uncle, Kenneth Pankey. As I delve deeper into the narrative, interviewing the myriad of individuals who graced his life, each conversation brought new insights and profound lessons. It's an indescribable feeling to have had the privilege of unearthing and weaving together these intimate stories, memories, and experiences. This film is more than just a biography. While it narrates the story of his life, it also mirrors his profound impact on those he met along the way. In crafting this enduring tribute to someone I deeply loved, I aimed to paint the full picture, not just the milestones and events, but the ripples he created in the hearts of many. Thank you for embarking on this journey with me. I hope that as you watch, you not only understand the essence of his life, but feel the warmth, influence, and legacy he left behind.
You know, you had, you know, Kenneth Pankey Sr. as a dad, as a husband, as a sibling, as an uncle. These were all vastly different people. Kenneth Pankey Sr. and at State Farm in the workplace. These are, you know, different people, and it's the same for anybody else.
I just miss him so. I miss him dearly.
A man that knows who he is. A man unapologetically himself.
And you know what? I can't say goodbye, and I won't say goodbye. I won't. I won't.
It was one of those things where everything that he did for me really, really set in stone for me and made me to the man I am today. I remember and cherish every moment.
So you asked me about Kankakee. Kankakee is a rural town. It's very small. It's probably about an hour south of Chicago. And there were roughly around 60,000 people in Kankakee. So a very small city. But it was one of those cities where everybody knew everybody because it was so small.
In the sleepy city of Kankakee, in the rural plains outside of Chicago, Kenneth Charles Pankey was born August 13, 1953. Kenneth was the eldest son of the late Clyde Pankey, a high school football star turned factory worker, and Lucille Pankey, née Cochran, a former beauty queen who worked nights at one of the largest psychiatric hospitals in the country. There was a time when you planned your errands to make sure you were out of West Kankakee during the shift changes at Roper Corporation's stove manufacturing plant. You wanted to avoid the traffic when thousands of employees were heading in or heading home. Everyone had a relative working there, and if you didn't, you wished you did. The Daily Journal. Clyde Pankey was a large man from Bolivar, Tennessee. He spent his days on the factory floor of Roper's and his evenings as a janitor at Sully's restaurant. As the head of the modest Pankey household, he was a strict disciplinarian who dreamt of more than a harsh factory life for his young children.
That's one thing he wanted none of us to do, was to grow up and work in a factory. He always wanted us to continue our education with going to college and get some experience and degrees. He wasn't for factory work, especially for me since I was a girl. But I didn't know too much what he went through, but I got a whiff of it sometimes, you know, he would come home and not feel so good, not want to be bothered and stuff like that. So I knew how to hide.
Lucille Pankey was the daughter of a farmer from Pelham, Georgia. Following her sisters north to Kankakee, she met a young Clyde Pankey while on a date with another guy. Working the night shift at Manteno State Mental Hospital enabled her to be hands-on with her children's education and spiritual well-being.
She went to work at about 11. She always took a nap. After she fed us and stuff, she took a nap. And then around about 10 o'clock or so, she'll wake up, get ready to go to work. And so the following morning, she'll be coming in and fix our breakfast and all that, or my dad would fix our breakfast. And that's the way she did it for 17 years. You know, I didn't know nothing different. And my dad, he worked at Roper, so that was just normal for the family.
At 740 North Rosewood Avenue, between East Mulberry and Willow Street, is a vacant lot which was, at one time, the site of the Pankey family home. In the early 1970s, the Pankey family of five would move to 267 North Myrtle Avenue, a home that remained in the family until the passing of Lucille Pankey. Here, across these two homes, the Pankey children would develop their faith, industriousness, and commitment to family, and where a young Kenneth Pankey would develop his loving, if not rebellious, spirit.
Growing up in Kankakee, my parents instilled in us in two really important things. One was religion and Christianity and making sure that we had faith. And the other was hard work and education. So that was really the foundation for us growing up. The other thing that they instilled in us was making sure that we understood the value of family and how important family was. So we would often hear, when there's no one else in your life, you always have family. So, you know, that was sort of the what they instilled in us. So growing up in Kankakee was difficult at times because we didn't have a lot. You know, we were had meager means. We didn't really realize it at the time because our home was filled with so much love that we didn't realize that we didn't have everything that other people had in other neighborhoods.
We was poor and didn't even know we was poor then. You know, looking back at some of the pictures and stuff. Because we had both parents in the household. Everybody else had the same thing, you know, so we fit in quite well.
Raised in a tight-knit family with strong moral values, it's easy to believe the typical child would be as upright as they come. But young Kenneth was anything but typical.
My brother, there is a 5-year age gap between my brother and I. And what I remember about him growing up is that he was quite the practical joker. So, you know, he would jump out of a closet to scare you. You know, he was always doing something sort of to try and get under your skin. So he would jump out of the closet and scare my sister. One time that didn't work too well for him because, you know, she turned around and started fighting him and got the better of him that night.
Yeah, he never did that again. See, my brothers would always try to dare me or scare me. And that was the wrong thing to do. Yeah, he did. He jumped out of the closet. I turned around, started swinging instead. I was shouting and swinging. So he got a lot of haymakers in the face.
You know, he was always sort of picking at me and doing things. But I looked up to him. I recall one time my brother came to me and I was probably 5 or 6 years old. And he said, you know, Bruce, I've got some bad news. And I said, well, what is it? Well, Bruce, you know, you're adopted. You know, my parents brought you home from the hospital and, you know, you're adopted and you're not really my brother. And I was like, that's not true. you know, I said, I got all upset. I started crying. I said, well, I'm going to go and ask mom and dad. And he said, don't do that, because they're not going to tell you the truth, Bruce. They told me not to tell you, and they're not going to tell you the truth. So I went in and asked my parents. I said, you know, Kenny said, I was so upset. He said, Kenny told me that I was adopted. And they just started laughing. It was like, no, that's not true, Bruce. You know, you're our child. We had you. We brought you home from the hospital. You're our child. And so I went back in there to tell Kenny. I was like, you know, you were lying. They told me that I was their child. He said, Bruce, I told you they were not going to tell you the truth. And so, you know, so for really years, I was kind of wondering, am I really a member of this family? But, you know, as I grew older, I realized that he was just joking. But yeah.
For centuries, the Black church has been a cornerstone of African American life, a place of refuge and empowerment in the face of oppression and adversity. From its earliest roots in slavery to the present day, the Black church has played a vital role in shaping the history of America.
Yeah, I went to Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church, and it's not like we had a choice to go. You know, on Sunday morning, my mom would say, get up and let's go. And it was me and my brother, and my sister. My dad, he didn't attend church like that, like the local churches, but he was very religious. I mean, he would always listen to all of the Christian shows on TV. And so he had these television ministries that he would follow, and he would, you know, reading his Bible and have a little Bible study when they had Bible study, and, you know, he'd mark up his Bible. So he was very in tune, you know, to religion, and that's how he was raised. He was raised in the church. So we had that foundation in our home.
Sunday mornings have always been a time for families to gather and worship and fellowship. For the Pankey children, that weekly ritual was also an opportunity for fun and games.
We had to go. It wasn't an option. We had to go to Sunday school and church, especially if we wanted to go to the theater, the Luna or Paramount Theater after church. We had to go to church. We had to. So we didn't have problems getting up, going to church, because we knew that we'll get our dollar and something to pay our way into the show and get some popcorn and candy and a drink.
You know, and our mom would try and teach us about tithing and giving to the church. So she would give us a little bit of money, and she'd give me money and give Kenny money to put into the church plate. And, you know, my brother, he said, well, Bruce, we're going to the movies later. Don't put all of your money in the church. You need to keep a little bit for the movie theater to buy candy and popcorn. So, you know, he did teach me. He was kind of a bad influence, but when I was at the movies, I did appreciate the fact that I had a little money for popcorn and candy.
In the tapestry of family life, each member weaves a unique thread, adding richness and depth to the collective fabric. This is especially true in the Pankey household. Each child embraced a distinct role. For Kenneth, it was that of the protector.
Besides being a prankster, you know, we all sort of had our role in the family. My sister was very caring and nurturing, and, you know, she would make cookies and popcorn and things like that. And, you know, I was always sort of the peacemaker. I wanted everybody to get along. So I was always, you know, sort of making sure that everything was going smoothly. And my brother, I guess I would describe him as sort of the protector of the family. He really wanted to make sure that My sister was, nobody was bothering her, that she was protected.
You know, I depended on him for my protection, for my safety. I could always go to him when I had situations, and he would listen. He was very protective of me, and he was just there. Whatever, even when I never did tell him nothing was going on, he would figure it out himself. He would make the time.
But for me, he wanted to make sure that I knew how to fight. So, you know, the first lesson that he taught me is that you have to get hit, and that it's not the worst thing in the world to get hit, and that will help you to get over your fears. So that was not the easiest lesson to learn. But you know, he taught me what I needed to know to be a young man out in the streets that I was living in. But in addition to that, you know, having an older brother and having an older sister was an advantage for me, because if I needed help in school, or if I needed to know how to do something, or if I had questions, I always had somebody to go to.
He was a leader. If anything was going on, he was part of it. He was the instigator, or he was the person who calmed the whole situation down. He was always in a leader position, always.
Yeah, I think he was respected in the neighborhood. He managed to, some of his friends were older, and he ended up becoming friends with guys that taught him how to fight, and, you know, would sort of take him under his wing. And, you know, he was always the one that was out in the street doing something, right? He was always busy. You know, my sister and I were a little more reserved, but Kenny, he used to say that he was a black sheep of the family. And that, compared to my sister and I, that's probably true, because he was much more daring and would go out and try different things and get into a little bit of trouble. Yeah, you know, when he was early growing up, and we'd get into things, but, you know, he would drink a little bit, but he never did drugs. He just never, you know, that was not something that he was into. And you would think that a guy that was always a risk taker and doing different things would get into things that, you know, like drugs, but he never did.
He loved playing baseball. He loved playing baseball. My dad was real active with both the boys in sports and football too. They would go to the games or whatnot with practices. And I was into things with my mom. You know, I did things with my mom, but my brothers did things with my dad. So he was pretty active in baseball, football, going to the Y. He was just into everything, dances, all the things like that. Typical black American boy.
Welcome to one of the warmest, most human sports events of any year, the Little League World Series from Williamsport, Pennsylvania. Again in 1966, little leaguers from all over the world have come to this beautiful little ballpark in Williamsport, where today, in color, you'll see a new world champion decided. Also on Wide World of Sports this afternoon, we'll present a preview of the heavyweight championship fight scheduled for a week from today between the champion, Cassius Clay or Muhammad Ali, and the challenger, the European champion, Carl Mildenberger of Germany. But right now, the business at hand is baseball.
No. All I know is he and my parents went there, but I didn't go. I had to stay home for school. And I really didn't know the significance of the Little League World Series, you know, the kids, you know, I never did think of it as anything exciting, because I'm not a sports fan. But evidently it was. It was a big thing for my brother.
Good afternoon. I'm Jim McKay. And if there's one word that describes our annual trip to Williamsport, that word is fun, because that's what it is. It's just plain fun to come up here and meet these youngsters and talk to them from all over the world, to see a crowd of better than 20,000 people, none of whom pay, by the way, come out on a late, hot summer afternoon to see a real old-fashioned ball game with cotton candy and snowballs for the kids and hot dogs, the whole thing just the way you remember it when you were a youngster, except this time the principals are the kids, not the grown-ups, The survivors are some 4,000 teams from all over the world that started out in tournament play. Just two are left, the team from Houston, Texas, and the team from a place with the improbable name of West New York, New Jersey. It's just on the other side of the Hudson from New York City.
In 1966, the eyes of the world were focused on Williamsport, Pennsylvania, where the Little League World Series was about to unfold. On one side of the field were the Kankakee JCs from Illinois, a team of young, talented players eager to make their mark on the world stage. Among them, Ken Pankey, center fielder and cleanup hitter. On the other side were their opponents, a team from Monterrey, Mexico, eager to prove their own skills and determination. The game was tense, with both teams playing with heart and determination. But it was the Kankakee JCs who ultimately emerged victorious, securing their place in the annals of Little League history.
They had a parade. I remember when they came back, they had a parade. Downtown Kankakee, you know how short Court Street is from one end to the other. They had a nice homecoming parade for them. And that's all I remember.
When they came back from Williamsport, Pennsylvania, that's when my mother and father started having some marital problems. And my mother moved out of the house for a while. And then she came back home and my father moved out of the house. And so we all thought that, you know, this was a very difficult time for us because we thought our parents were going to get divorced. And in those days, that didn't happen.
It's a town that had every household had both parents in it. You know, both parents were present in the household. So we didn't have, I don't remember any single mothers or single parents. If there were, it was only one I could remember. But most of our households was the parents and the kids.
It really impacted all of us very differently. Kenny, you know, he sort of spiraled out of control and started getting into trouble. And he actually left home. You know, he ran away from home and he was living on the street for a while. And then he started living with one of my cousins. But he continued to go to school, continued to do all the things he was supposed to do. So from the time he was probably 13 until 14 and a half, he was not living with us. And then he eventually came back home when he was around 14 and a half. And between 14 and 16, he got a young lady pregnant and had his daughter, Teresa, and he got one of the girls that lived up the street from us, Valerie Brewster, he got her pregnant around the same, a little after that. So by the time he was 16, he was getting married. He was getting, you know, he had to get permission from my parents. And my mother agreed to it, but my father was very strict. He was totally opposed to it. And he didn't want them to get married. You know, he thought he was too young. He was making a mistake. But he ended up getting married anyway.
Yeah, he was young. He grew up in adulthood very quick. I think my parents had to sign for him. Yeah, they had to sign for him because he was underage. And they didn't, my dad didn't want him to do it. But mom went on and signed the papers and they got married.
He grew up extremely fast in a very short period of time. And then from there, he went on, he graduated from high school, then he went into the military. And then, you know, he went on to do other things, to get jobs and do other things. So there was this whole time period there where he spiraled out of control. And it really changed, I think, it changed how he acted and how, you know, he was rebellious with his parents because of that hurt.
In the early 1970s, at the age of 17, Kenneth enlisted in the United States Air Force. There, he learned the self-discipline he would exhibit for the rest of his life.
It was interesting because I didn't know that he was going into the military. You know, he told me about it, he talked to me about it, and I was afraid. I was like, man, you're gonna die. You know, and it was after the Vietnam War and things like that. It was much later, but I'm like, oh, something's going to happen to you and won't come back. So I was really nervous about it. And he's, you know, I'm fine, I'll be fine. But, you know, he was looking at it in terms of, well, I can go in and get the GI Bill and that'll pay for college. And, you know, he was very strategic in making that move going into the military. And, you know, it benefited him throughout his life. He was able to get a VA loan to get a house and do different things. But I think more than anything, it taught him discipline. And by the time he went to college, he was so disciplined that he went through college in 3 years. I mean, he was very mature for his age because he had gone through the military. So it was something that worked out for him. And thank God, you know, he never saw any kind of action or anything like that and came home in one piece.
After graduating from college with a young family to provide for, Kenneth quickly realized there was little opportunity in rural Illinois. Scouring the nation for employment, Kenneth eventually ventured out to Richmond, Virginia.
Kenny was the first to go. He got a job working for a YMCA in Richmond, Virginia, and he loved that job. But they actually moved him out to Richmond. He had been applying for jobs all over the place when he graduated from college. And that was the first one that came up, you know, and they offered to move him out there. So he moved in his whole family out there. And he worked in that job until he started working for the courts as a probation officer.
Juvenile Domestic Relations Court. We worked with Ken many years. We loved him. He was the brother that we didn't realize we had in addition to the ones that we already have. We love him so much. We miss him. Thank you so much for being a part of our lives for so long. I'm Joyce.
I'm Curtis.
I'm Nikki.
Gail.
Willie. I'm Alex.
And Carolyn.
After working as a probation officer for the Richmond Juvenile and Domestic Relations Court in Chesterfield County, Ken joined State Farm Insurance as a claims adjuster in August of 1985. Known as a tough but soft-spoken negotiator, Ken would retire from this, his longest tenured position, as a team manager in 2017.
Those folks up the road have a good car insurance agent, and they told their neighbors. These folks told their neighbors that same agent was good for life and health insurance, too. And this family recommended the same agent to insure their neighbor's home. Why do so many people end up buying all their insurance from a State Farm agent? Ask a neighbor.
State Farm is there. Yeah. Well, both of us worked at State Farm Insurance, and we met in 1985. I think maybe somewhere around August. I started with State Farm in January of 85, and I think he came in August. So we met then in August, and I was in a different department almost. I was a claims estimator. I was writing estimates on cars at the time, and he was a claim rep. So I was in and out of the office. But the next year, I became a claim rep also. So we were together all the time in the office, just friends from, you know, we built a friendship quick. You know, it wasn't a long time. You know, we became friends right away.
We both started at State Farm at the same time.
we became good friends. And it's a good thing you only know Ken as an uncle. I knew him very well.
We were still, I think, in the same office for a while, but he got promoted. So we worked together. We worked together in the office. I learned a lot of stuff from him because he was a clean rep before me, and then he was a bodily injury clean rep before me. So I just learned a whole lot of stuff from him while we were clean reps. One thing that was funny about him, he always would talk low on the telephone when he was negotiating claims. You know, I'm talking loud. You know, I'm talking loud. I'm off you $500. That's it. You know, he's on the telephone like, shh, shh. Next thing you know, he done closed the claim. I ain't heard a word of what he said. he was almost like, I don't want you to learn my skills. You know, I can't give my skills, my trade secrets away. And next thing I know, this guy got promoted. You know, he is promoted. He left me, he is promoted. I left that office and went to another office. He got promoted, was gone for about 10 years. Then he came back and ended up being my supervisor. So the thing was, he was my supervisor. Here it is, Ken is my supervisor. Me and him did stuff together. And now things had changed in between that 10-year period. By the time he came back, I was a pastor.
Eventually, Rudy became a minister. Tony Jones, another fellow in the group, quit State Farm and became a minister. And I think if given a little more time, Ken Pankey would probably put his wayward ways aside, and I think he was headed in that direction.
I became a deacon back in like 1989. And, you know, we're just, and then after a couple of years and everything, he started saying, yeah, I was raised in the church and my family in the church. And I was almost like, what? What? But the older he got, the more I saw. And he used to sing with the group, I can't think, the Amen Corner. The Amen Corner is the name of the group. And they sung without music. And they used to go around singing. I've been with them a couple of times. I preach, and they have sung back up at some church. And then they started getting older and everything and not going around. But about 10 years ago, they were going around. He would go on a bus trip every Labor Day weekend or Memorial Day weekend. They would go on a bus trip to South Carolina or something. And sing at different churches and everything. Yeah.
Ken told me he was in a singing group, a gospel group. So my question to him was, what's your name? He said, you always think I'm doing something. I said, Ken, I know you are... Again, trying to be respectful of Pat and Val. You know there has to be some other motivation other than your desire to sing to get you going to rehearsal two nights a week and then traveling with a group on Sundays to different churches. It has to be more motivation than just your desire.
He called himself telling me how to sing. I'm a preacher, but I ain't no singing preacher. But I come from a family of singers. So he telling me how to sing and say, man, you got to sing like you're talking almost. Don't try to go deviate your voice. Try to stay at that same pitch that you talk. And I'm like, Come on, you man, Barry White or somebody. He tried to teach a 40-year-old man how to sing during that time. 50. He tried to tell a 50-year-old man how to sing. And I came from a singing family. That's the thing.
Deep in the heart of the Allegheny Mountains, nestled among the rolling hills and verdant forests of Virginia, lies a true American treasure, the Homestead Resort. For over two centuries, this sprawling property has been a beacon of luxury, relaxation, and world-class hospitality.
We went to the homestead. Of course, Ken Pankey had to show himself. We were in this very good environment, and we were required to dress at tea time, and then again suit and tie at dinner. That was the homestead at the Greenbrier, the same situation of the older self. We then went to Pinehurst. Neither one of us in our group played golf. So Ken and Andy and I had a cottage down at Pinehurst. So for us, it was a time to sit and drink and look at the people in the rain golfing. And then my friend Andy, we got ready for bed. We had three bedrooms. Andy walks out with a nightgown on. And what did he do that for? Ken Pankey laughed until he cried, because all he needed was a cap to go with the nightgown. And being the type of people that Ken was and I was, we had no pajamas. But when Andy walked out with that nightgown on, that was the last thing we could do but contain ourselves.
And just hilarious things that, you know, just hilarious stuff. You know, like he would try to egg me on about stuff, and I egg him on about stuff. And he's like, man, I don't believe you let him do that. He must see some weak in you. He always saying stuff like that. And so here I am, a pastor of a church, and he's still trying to make me get in my flesh. Hey, man, he's also weak. I don't believe. Man, I thought you from P-Town. I'm a member of Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated. I'm a Q. He was like, man, I thought you were cute, man. You look like that guy. Man, I thought y'all Qs. That's why I'm glad I ain't played. You know, just constant. Anything he could egg and get under your skin with me and him, we're back and forth. We're just back and forth. So
what was funny, when we first met, both of us were young. I was 5 years younger. You know, me and my wife had just had one baby at that time. Didn't have no money. I didn't have no money. Ken really won't make a whole lot of money. So we used to go to lunch with these people, and these people go to lunch and go to all these restaurants and everything. So around about 11:55, me and him would meet up in an office somewhere and say, man, how much money you got? And I said, man, I got a couple of dollars. How much money you got? So we would tell him, y'all go ahead, we're gonna catch up with y'all. And we walk across the street to McDonald's and eat. By the time they come back in the office, we sitting in our office like we'd have been out to some big restaurant or whatever. That's hood thinking. But we were like that. You know, we looked out for each other, we fed off each other.
Then Ken, Andy, and I would meet on January 1st, New Year's Day. And we would drink, play cards, tell lies. And his wife made a comment. That was another situation that caused all of us to just burst out laughing. Andy was a good person, though. And but Ken would make the smallest thing the biggest joke. And he had a personality that was unbelievable. You see him in the office, he would he was very professional. And in the street, he was a clown.
And so the friendship, you know, our friendship was State Farm, how people say, is where we met. But our friendship wasn't State Farm. Our friendship was just, we just boys, we just friends. And we just happened to come to work during the day, but we're friends. You know, we're going at lunch, we're talking about things, we're joking about things, we are encouraging. We are supporting each other, you know, and in a way, we're not letting each other forget where we came from.
A surprise to very few, Kenneth was not winning any awards as a husband, and his marriage to Valerie would later end in divorce. He would later meet Patricia, and Kenneth would marry for the second and final time.
My name is Patricia Pankey, Ken's wife. We were married on August the 21st, 1999, at Branches Baptist Church, by the late Reverend Richard S. Johnson Sr. Like with every marriage, there were good times and bad. But through it all, whatever the situation was, he always made sure that I had everything I needed. He was a good provider. He loved my kids like they were his own, and he raised one of my grandkids just like she was his daughter. And she still knows him as her dad still today and always. And I love his kids the same. When his mom took ill and we moved her to Virginia, taking care of her together was a pleasure. She will always have a place in my heart. The Lord called her home in August of 2019. Ken was right there by my side. Although he was going through his own issues, but God kept him strong to see Mom go on to glory. But no matter what he was going through, I was there to love him and took good care of him until the Lord called him home a year later, August of 2020. Thank you, Lord, for health and strength. Thank you, Lord, for 21 years with Ken. And thank everyone for the cards, words of encouragement, prayers during that time. Love you all.
Left to cherish his memory and carry on his spirit, Ken leaves behind two daughters,
two sons, 13 grandchildren, 16 great-grandchildren, and a host of nieces, nephews, relatives, and friends.
One, he was my father figure. You know what I'm saying? I don't even look at him or classify him as my grandfather. I kind of looked at him as my dad. So, you know, anytime I got some good news or anytime I wanted to share something, he was the one that I was calling. So
granddad, he... I'm sure you'll hear these common themes throughout this documentary, but he was very caring. He was everyone's number one supporter, especially mine. Always there for everyone. He had the best advice, the best criticism, that tough love. Really, really stick with you. Still stick with me to this day. But he's so caring. So you know, whatever advice he give you is from the heart. And it shaped me to be the man I am today. So I appreciate everything he's done for me.
He was just really somebody that I could talk to, just to keep it real. I felt like that's my uncle, you know? I felt like that's my uncle. Like I was the only person in his world, the only niece in his world. That's how he made me feel.
One thing about Uncle Kenny is he was who he was. And for all of his great things, his flaws, that's who he was. He was unapologetically himself. And that's what I took kind of from him, was to be you, authentically you, and never deny yourself who you are. And never hide from who you are.
So now back to what kind of fellow was Kenny. Admired by all of his relatives. He was a good mixer with family. I would say personality was likable and relatable. And so that's where I would characterize him, mostly likable. Because of all the family members that knew him, they all had positive things to say about him. Lucille's oldest son, and they go on from there. And they would talk about him in a very positive way.
Kenneth can be described a lot of different ways, depending on who you ask. But one thing they'll all say, Ken was cool.
Hands down, the coolest dude I knew personally. He was as cool as Samuel Jackson in my mind, and was just a really sort of positive figure in my life and one of my favorite people.
Uncle Kenny was the absolute coolest. He was smooth. He was cool, but I would say he was more smooth than cool. Just his whole mannerism. You never saw, I heard, Uncle Kenny had a temper, but you never saw that. He was always even-keeled and chill. And that's one of the characteristics I definitely try to steal from my uncle, is to just be smooth and even-keeled, not show too high of emotion, not show too low of emotion, just be steady. And yeah, he was smooth in everything that he did, and being smooth made him cool. Does that make sense?
I won't say he was quiet, but he was, I think he was realistic. And the things he said, you paid attention to it. And he didn't talk a lot about things he didn't know anything about. So when we talked, it was always about the family, more than just his family, because he knew a lot about his aunts and a couple uncles. He knew a lot about his aunts. So they were all there in Kankakee. And so he had a chance to really communicate and establish relationships with all of his aunts, because all six of them was there.
Very laid back, like a cool personality. Seemed like he had a lot he was thinking about, but he didn't say a lot. But when he had something to say, he would say it. So I felt like every word that would come out of his mouth, I felt like I'd had to grab on to each word.
I say, you know, he was a real chill, laid back, really didn't take no BS, you know. If it was something that I was telling him that I was going to do, he kind of wanted me to stick to it and make sure I got it done. Now, if I said I'm going to do something, he would kind of like, he one of them people that I got to see it before I have to believe him. I'm not sure if it's the same for Kendrick, but, you know, but when it came to me, it was kind of like, you know, I need to see it. And then once I see you doing it and you putting efforts to it, then I'm gonna believe you. I'm gonna ride with you. So it was kind of like that. It was definitely chill, laid back.
Everyone knows that's my number one guy, my man's my number one. So he's my mentor, coach, father figure, all of the above. Since the day I was able to walk, he's been there for me. He's been a person that I've looked up to in every aspect of my life. Everything my granddad did, I wanted to do. And my earliest memories, him teach me how to ride a bike. Every Christmas, he'll get me some new roller skates. It was one of those things where everything that he did for me really, really set in stone for me and made me to the man I am today. I remember and cherish every moment.
You know, you had, you know, Kenneth Pankey Sr. as a dad, as a husband, as a sibling, as an uncle. These were all vastly different people. Kenneth Pankey Sr. and at State Farm in the workplace. These are, you know, different people, and it's the same for anybody else. We all act differently based on the social situations. And, you know, what I experienced personally was the uncle. And it was nothing but, you know, positivity.
Our relationship was like father son, because everything we talked about, it was more so like a father perspective, because, you know, with the grandfathers, they kind of more lenient with their grandchildren. He wasn't like that with me, especially by me growing up where I was coming from. He wanted to make sure that I was always good and always doing what was best for me. So like one of the things he always used to tell me and my brother was, make sure you get your degree, you know what I'm saying? Make sure you keep your credit straight, because if you get your degree and keep your credit straight, you can do whatever you want to do. You can get whatever you want to get. So those was the main two things that he was on us from the time that we was able to process information to the time he passed. Just make sure you keep your credit straight and make sure you get your degree. So our relationship, it was like I said, it wasn't grandfather, son, and grandson, because like when I was wrong, most of the time, the grandfather, you know, cheer you up or tell you it's okay. No, if I was wrong, he was letting me know, like, yo, this ain't right. This ain't what you're supposed to be doing. So, like I said, it was sometimes when it got like, all right, granddad, or all right, dad, like, you know what I'm saying? So, but most of the time, it was definitely like a good father-son relationship to me.
But, you know, I mean, the uncle is, especially your dad's brother is always, you know, kind of a bizarro version of your father, but also you have the added benefit of a guy that never whooped you. So you get, you know, a lot of the benefits that you have with your dad, but, you know, none of the drawbacks, none of the hurt feelings, things like that. And, you know, I think most men have that relationship with their uncles, just being, you know, someone you're really close with, someone that, you know, didn't have to raise you, so they can kind of see you from a different light and a different perspective, and, you know, appreciate you, you know, in a different way.
Yes, he was cool. Yes, he was laid back. But these weren't his best qualities. Ken was a lot of things to a lot of people, chief among them. He was a man who knew what you needed to hear and doled out advice to those closest to him.
He was one big on morals, and he taught me to take everything seriously. You know, don't cheat life. No shortcuts. And so I took that approach with sports. I took it with school, elementary, middle, high school, especially college and getting into college. And then, you know, into the corporate world as well. So his biggest thing was, you know, live life to the fullest, but be intentional with it. No shortcuts. Don't cheat it. And so that's the biggest thing. You know, even now, I'm the man I am today, that still lives on with me.
So there's a story, and I don't know if I told too many people about this story. So I didn't realize when I was in high school that I had test anxiety. So I just didn't take tests well. And I was taking the SATs, and I took it twice and didn't fare well on the SATs at all. And I forgot why Uncle Kenny was with us. I don't know if we had done a family trip somewhere or something, but we had traveled back to our house in Gaithersburg, and Uncle Kenny was with us, and it was late. It was almost like midnight, and I ran to the mailbox because this was the second time I had taken the SAT, and I ran to the mailbox to get my score, and I went back in the house, and the score was worse than the first time, and it was not something that I was happy about. So I went to the basketball court, and I shot around a little bit, and then the first person I saw when I came back inside was Uncle Kenny. And he just said, "So what you gonna do?" So I'm gonna take it again. He's like, "That's what I wanted to hear." And he was the right person at the right time to be there. I had decided I was gonna do it anyway, but he was definitely the right person to just be like, "Yeah, that's what I wanted to hear. You're doing the right thing." So our relationship, yeah, he's my uncle. I would get advice from him without actually realizing that I was getting advice from him growing up. And so we were closer than just a uncle and nephew. We shared a very special bond that I'll never forget. Because like I said, he was cool, smooth Uncle Kenny, but also that person that could just be like, "What you gonna do? I'm gonna do this again. That's what I wanted to hear. And I needed that." So yeah.
Be a lady. Be a lady. No matter what, no matter what environment, if you're out, you know, with your friends and everything like that, and even if everybody's acting, you know, crazy around you, make sure you maintain who you are, and be a woman, be a lady, and just handle it like that. Have a certain stature about yourself.
You know, gave me, you know, advice on things I should do in my career and things I should do in my personal life that helped build a great deal of confidence and, you know, was very instrumental in making me to the man I am today.
He started me off young. You know, he got me into playing basketball, something that everyone knows that wasn't my thing. But, you know, I was more focused on the books. I let my brother be the basketball. My cousin got a shout out, Bruce, too. But my granddad got into basketball, and he was there for me every step of the way. You know, no matter how many points I score, how many layups I miss, how many turnovers I had, he was always there. And so that meant a lot for me to support me in something that I wasn't really not meant to be, but that wasn't something that I personally grew into to like until he kind of got me into it.
When I used to travel to different states to play basketball, he used to come to every game, whether it was in Florida, New Jersey, it don't matter what the game was at. He came to every game. He missed not one of my games from the time I started playing basketball to college. He missed not one game. He was there every game. Even if Lex had a game, he was at both our games. So he never missed a game.
He was that guy that, you know, as I navigated life and I was in the neighborhood I grew up in, it was very easy to, you know, get mixed up into the mix and things that's going on in the neighborhood. So he made sure I stayed focused and had my goal early on from an early age. And I was always that student that, you know, I wanted to make my granddad proud. So he had nothing to worry about with me. He took an approach where he was hands off, but he trusted me to get stuff done. And that taught me a lot of accountability because I wanted to make him proud. But every step of the way, even high school, I remember the day where he made me, because he made me. He made me come over, and I busted out maybe like five different applications to colleges all in one night, and different essays that he looked over for me, and applications, and applying for schools and FAFSA, all of that stuff. He helped me do that. I joke back now because, and then professionally, he also started to do my taxes. And you know, last couple of years, my first time looking at it, like, all right, who gonna do this for me? I don't know how to do this. So, some things I had to learn now. So I'm not used to that. But I mean, anything you can think of, every big moment, every big step in my life, I will bet you a granddad taught me or did it for me. So now I'm teaching myself how to do my taxes.
Well, you know, he got me. My career in general is because of him. He's the one that got me into insurance. And my role in insurance got me into consulting, which is where I am now. It's one led right to the other. And so basically, my entire career is due in large part to him. And I'm very happy with where I am in life and what I have. And he was a huge, huge impact on that, as well as, you know, just great advice. Make your money, save your money. That's what he said when he was under the influence of some painkillers after a surgery or right before surgery, and a phone call to me. It's basically all he was able to get out, but it was good advice. Made my money and I saved my money as best I can.
Funny story, I always say, and I told him too, you know, it's not too many pieces of advice that my granddad gave me that I did not follow. The one I will say is the exception is sticking with engineering. He really pushed me to be that engineer in the family. He pretty much pushed me, made sure I wanted to accomplish those goals and help guide that way. But I was fortunate enough to learn an opportunity in insurance. And like I said, I always joke with him that this is the next best thing, and he was proud of that. And so every step of my career, my professional career, he was the first person that knew every accomplishment I made. So I remember my first time being promoted to senior claims rep, and he was super excited. And he's like, don't stop here. A year and a half later, I was promoted to supervisor. And I told him, I don't know if I'm ready for this role. And he said, son, you're ready. You know, if your team and your staff and your management think you're ready, then you're ready for it. So I took it on, and, you know, I've made that a successful part of my career as well. And then about a year ago, I was promoted to manager. So I'm pretty sure he's happy for that accomplishment as well. So as soon as I got, I was proud because I know that I'm still making him proud, and he can look down and smile on that accomplishment as well. So that was my guy.
I miss him every day, but his words are always ringing in my head. I tried to be a better man because of the lessons that he taught me. And I know he taught me all of his children, all of his grandchildren, all of his great-grandchildren. Lessons to be better than him, because that's what the next generation always wants to pass on. This is the way I did it. I made some mistakes. Here's some advice so you don't make the same mistakes. Be better than I was. And so that's all I try to do, is make sure that I'm the man that he envisioned I could be, but still being authentically myself. But still growing and learning and evolving to being a better man. And that's the lesson that I truly, truly took from him. Because he was always evolving. He was always trying to be better than he was the day before. And so that's one of the main lessons. When I pray at night, I pray to God and my family, I just want to be a better man tomorrow than I was today. Each day being a better man. And that's one of the main things that I learned from him.
You know, before he left, he knew how much he meant to me. I have no regrets about my relationship with him and not being able to, you know, not being able to spend time with him. It's like some situation where I got to spend that time and and you know, and get to know him very well.
I don't even think there's even words that I can even describe. How he's impacted me. He's impacted my whole being. He's impacted me as a woman, as a professional, as a goal setter, as a person. And it's just, it's not a day that goes by that I don't think of him in some type of way. So, He's been impactful. He will always be an impact in my life, because I know that there's conversations that we've had and that there's things that I need to do because he would want me to do them. He would want me to pursue that, you know, because he know I would, that's what I want for myself. So he wanted what I wanted for myself, the good things I wanted for myself.
All in all, my granddad taught me to live life to the fullest. Don't cheat the game. Don't take no shortcuts. He was very resilient. And so I wear that on my sleeve proudly as well. He taught me the epitome of being a Pankey man. He was my mentor, someone I really, really looked up to. The things that I've learned from him helped navigate every aspect of my life, like I mentioned. And he was big on that self-confidence. And so now I feel like I can walk into any room and know that I belong there. And 100% of that is from the stuff that and the lessons that he's taught me. It was very interesting approach. Like I mentioned, every step of my life, he was able to hands on, hands off. Okay, Kendrick is in college now, but I'm gonna still support him. I'm gonna come visit him. So it was something that I can carry on to my kids and my future kids and grandkids. So everything that he's done, I'm just like, all right, cool. Here's the blueprint. And it was some great lessons that, I'm great to cherish those and live his legacy on. And I hope I can continue to make him proud.
I think about him all the time. I got pictures of him all throughout the house. And it was more so like, I wasn't really emotional about it. Like I cried in the shower the first time, but it's just like everything that he told me, I'm just making sure I'm doing good. My degree helped me get my own business. I got my own mental health agency open. I got a group home open. So it's like I'm doing everything the right way, keeping my credit straight. You know what I'm saying? So it's like about all the stuff that he told me to do is actually paying off, because now I don't have to work for nobody. I wake up when I want to wake up. I have employees that work under me. You know what I'm saying? My girlfriend is my office manager. She take care of everything. So it's like, everything that he propelled me for that I wasn't able to see back then is all coming into fruition right now. So it's like I'm forever thankful to him.
He was just a wonderful person that people loved. I certainly loved him. And I'm going to miss him very much.
I'm hurt that he's not here with me and Bruce, you know, and I'll always miss him. And he was just very important to me in my life. And he seemed like he left too soon, you know.
On August 20th, 2020, we lost a remarkable man. Kenneth Charles Pankey Sr., a beloved husband, father, grand and great grandfather, brother, uncle, and friend, passed away due to complications from lung cancer. But even in death, his legacy lives on.
It's hard talking about him in the past tense, because I still feel like he's here. And it's very, very difficult because I feel like I can't even believe it, even to this day, that he's gone. Like, it's hard for me to even say that.
You know, one last thing. I'm probably the last person that he talked to night before he passed, he got Pat to call me. And so he was just on the other line. You know, so he won't say anything. So it was just me and him on the line. You know, I kept saying, Ken, I love you, man. I love you. You know, I love you. And like the next day, I went to see him and everything. So that's one thing. More than likely, I might have been, you know, that last person that you talked to.
Losing him was, you know, one of the biggest losses for me in my life. And I still feel it today. Like I said, you know, my dad's brother, my mom's mother, and, you know, that I lost them when they were so young, and I felt like probably should have had a lot more time and a lot of good years left, makes you appreciate every moment you have and to live it as full as you possibly can within reason. And anybody in your life that you love or you appreciate, you care about, take that time to spend with them. And cherish those moments.
Every time we go to visit, our daughter lives in Virginia, we stop by Kenny's house, and he would always have fish and beer, which I love those too. And he loved beer. So we had a time to communicate more during that time than any other time. So it was probably a couple of years before he passed, maybe 3 years before he passed, that I had the closest connection with him.
Let's get ready, then I can talk. This is Kenny. Somewhere to go.
Lighten up the white folks' plates. That's my big brother. He live in a mansion, y'all.
See?
Hey, we're moving on up.
That's how lies get started.
To the east side. See, I use matches. What's that?
That's how lies get started.
He probably ordered that off of Amazon.
I do order a lot off of Amazon.
Take care of me, 'cause I'm gonna